For the next 30 minutes on BBC One West, we invite you to join Barry Paine for a day out exploring the beautiful Chew Valley.
Chew Valley Lake, the centrepiece of a lush and beautiful area. To the north, 5 miles away over Dundry Hill, lies Bristol. To the east, Bath. To the west, Weston-super-Mare. And bounding the lake's southern shores, and the reason for its existence, the Mendip Hills. It looks for all the world as though nature had created it, not Bristol Waterworks in 1956. And around it, and nearby Blagden Lake, are scattered a maze of mostly prosperous villages, linked by minor roads, hiding almost from the major conurbations that seem so close. But, of course, these villages have been discovered by the commuters, who buy up the old cottages and push prices up for the locals. For better or worse, village life is changing. But in the Chew Valley, there seems to be a sense of balance between the old farming communities and the new lifestyle.
This is Chew Stoke, just off the B3114, which takes you to the lake over there. A day out in the Chew Valley could lead you to discover many such picturesque corners, and it yields some surprises too.
The Irish Bridge, as it's known, leads you into what's reputed to be the shortest street in England.
Well, by my reckoning, I'd say this street is about 53 paces long and, at its narrowest, about 2.5 paces wide. This row of cottages used to be part of the medieval main street of Chew Stoke. In 1972, it was bought and renovated by the District Council, a tribute, I'd say, to thoughtful planning and a delight to the visitor's eye. And as far as the people who live here are concerned, they even have music while they work.
Look to, trouble's going, she's gone.
The bells of St. Andrew's Church, Chew Stoke. The village team ring them regularly, and they're not the only ones, for bell ringers from all corners of England visit on outings to call the changes and ring the peals. These bells are famous. All 6 in the church tower were cast by one family, the Bilbys, who had a bell foundry in the village between 1690 and 1815. No trace of the foundry remains today, but the sound of these bells lives on. The Bilby's output was fantastic. Even today, over 70 West Country churches boast Bilby bells. The oldest bell cast by the family dates from 1698, and in common with other Bilby bells, all 6 here bear inscriptions which have a charm of their own. The number 2 bell reads, "My sound is good, well understood, as plainly doth appear. It was old Bilby and his friends as cast me to be here." And the great tenor bell says, "I to the church the living call, and to the grave do summon all." This is Chew Magna. It's always been a wealthy village. In Henry VIII's day, it was described as a pretty clothing town, with many mills operating on the banks of the River Chew, which runs through the village. Its industrial days are long past, but small businesses still thrive, and its neat shops, banks, and pubs draw many people from the surrounding area, for it's still one of the busiest and biggest villages in the Chew Valley. In Georgian times, these large houses were built mainly for professional and business people from Bristol, and they would seem to fulfil the same use for the commuters of today. This building, the old schoolroom, was probably built by a 16th century Bishop of Bath and Wells. It was first used as a lodging for the poor, and later became a schoolhouse. And there's been a St. Andrew's church here since the 12th century. The Bilby bells came later. And in the churchyard, an epitaph which reminds us that the journey to Bristol wasn't always that easy. Sacred to the memory of William Fowler of this parish, who was shot by an highwayman on Dundry Hill, June the 14th, 1814.
Legends and tall stories abound in this area. But inside the church, there's one story taller than most, concerning this fellow. This is a very rare effigy, carved in Irish oak, of a knight in 14th century armour. Historians tell us that the date and origins of this figure are unknown, but at some time it was inscribed with the name Sir John Hauteville. He was attributed with a great number of superhuman exploits. With his feet on a lion and his frame ready for action, he looks every inch the giant.
It's said that as a reward for services in the Holy Land, Sir John was granted the manor of Norton. He thought the reward inadequate because he dubbed the place Norton Mower Award, by which name it's known today.
The most remarkable story concerning Sir John Hauteville was that one day, in a trial of strength with the devil, he hurled a massive stone, nearly 6 feet in diameter, from the top of Maze Knoll, about a mile away, to the valley here. And here lies that stone, beside the Chew Magna to Pensford Road, as it has done for centuries.
The stone is now on its side, but once stood upright, and is almost certainly part of the Stanton Drew circles, which we'll be visiting later. At Stanton Drew, this hexagonal toll house must be familiar to many people travelling through the Chew Valley to Bristol. It's known locally as the Round House. It's a century since tolls have been extracted from travellers, but in the 1800s, a wagon would have been charged sixpence to travel a dirt road for a few miles, a cow cost a halfpenny, and the toll for a lamb, a farthing. Today, many people photograph this charming old house. Not everyone gets a chance to go inside.
Mrs. Rose? Hello.
Oh, yes.
Can I come in?
Oh, yes, please do.
Thank you. Well, it's very nice of you to invite me. Yeah. You know, I've been
the present owner, Elaine Rose, lives in what must be one of the tiniest houses in the land. I wondered if there was anything left to show that it had once been a toll house.
Oh, yes, there is the little sort of a till. The dresser over there have two slots in which they used to put the tolls.
There hardly seems to be room to swing the proverbial cat. How on earth do you live in here?
It is rather difficult, but one learns to manage. If one is having visitors, then all the preparations have to be done immediately beforehand and cleared up thoroughly before anybody arrives, because you can't kind of sling everything in, outside into the kitchenette, because the living room is the same kitchenette. The children from Stanton Drew Primary School have been here on two or three occasions, about 20 of them each time. And they're very interested. They love the shape of the house, and they love the funny little corners. And at Christmas time, on one occasion, every child sent me a Christmas card, and they had individually drawn the roundhouse. Their interpretation, very odd sometimes.
Have you lived here very long?
No. About 8 years, 8 to 10 years. But my mother was here previously, and she was here for 12 years. And she loved it just as much as I do.
Is there a room upstairs?
Yes, a lovely little bedroom. And you can actually, if we go upstairs, you'll be able to see the stones, you know.
I'd like to, yes,
oh,
yes, please.
Yes, thank you. Very nice. Thank you. Please be very careful here, because there's a very bad corner.
I see.
It curves around.
I I feel a bit like a bull in a china shop.
I'm sure you do. Do look out of this window, because beyond the trees are the stones.
The stone circles of Stanton Drew. What strange rituals have been enacted in this serene meadow over the years. Of course, playing a guessing game with history is the reason why they attract so many visitors each year, for no one really knows. But it is an eerie place. The stones are believed to date back to Neolithic times, 2,000 years before Christ, and it's thought possible that the three circles and the cove by the church were built to create a vast celestial calendar.
It's also said that if anyone tries to count the stones, they'll be struck down dead on the spot or carried off with an illness. I shall not attempt it. John Wood, the architect of Bath, came here in 1749 and tried it and got away lightly with a violent thunderstorm following him all the way home.
We were also told that the fields in which the stones stand are the most fertile in the valley, and that even on the hottest summer day, a chill breeze blows around.
But the most enduring legend about these stone circles is that concerning the celebrations following a country wedding here. The folk group, the Yetis, wrote a song about the outcome, carrying on a story that's been passed down the generations for hundreds of years.
Midsummer's Eve, it fell on a Saturday. Sue and William went to be wed. They had music played by a fiddler. Let's go dancing, William, he said. Midnight struck, and then said the fiddler, dancing on a Sunday wouldn't be right. Sue gave a laugh, don't care if to hell I go, I'll find another fiddler tonight. They dance, dance, dance around. They dance, dance to the fiddler's sound. Off went the fiddler, left them a-grumbling. Then another fiddler came along the way. Want to dance, and I'd like to play for you. Tunes he played, both merry and gay. Stop, cried the dancers. No, cried the fiddler. He kept on in spite of all their noise. They couldn't stop their jerking and stumbling. Then in a flash he turned them into stone. They danced, danced, danced.
And there they remain. The devil, for that was who the fiddler was, had had his wicked way and turned them all to stone. Happily, no such fate befell this wedding party, who gathered at St. Andrew's Church, Chew Magna, one autumnal day, to celebrate the marriage of Joanna and Philip Wareham.
There's 90 guests at the wedding here today. There is a reason why we got married at 12 o'clock midday today, because so many of Philip's family are in farming and they have to get back for milking between 3 and 4 this afternoon.
OK, any more aunties, cousins and grannies? Close relatives?
But this wedding isn't just enjoyed by the guests, but by the whole village, and in particular the children, who have a special role to play.
When we get to the church gates, I expect the children from the village have tied the gates with ribbon or a tie or something handy, and we have to throw pennies over the gates until they open the gates and let us go through. This is a very old tradition that happens in the Chew Valley area. I imagine there's going to be quite a few children from the village waiting at the gates, and hopefully we will have enough pennies to go round. I think it's only fair for them all to have a few pence each.
What
As soon as we're through the gate, that's when we are truly married. Then we can go into the old school room where we are having our reception, where there will be plenty of food and drink and a party in the evening.
Well, these day trippers might be enjoying a feast of a slightly more frugal nature, but the scenery more than makes up for it. Over the last 30 years, more and more people have been drawn to Chew Valley Lake, and Bristol Waterworks Company, who manage it, have cautiously built two picnic sites, popular with those folk who don't want to stray too far from the car. And, in fact, there's no need to, for the natives are friendly, on the whole. Along with Blagdon Lake, Chew Valley provides, at a price, some of the best trout fishing in Europe. There's a thriving sailing club with 500 enthusiastic members who sail all year round. And hundreds of naturalists and bird watchers flock here to spot the species. But whilst it provides an opportunity for all kinds of leisure pursuits, Chew Valley Lake has a job to do, for it's a man-made reservoir, helping to provide water for a million people in the West Country. It was opened by a young Queen Elizabeth on 17th of April 1956, a big event in the area and still remembered by many. But like all schemes of its size and scale, it wasn't without its opposition. In order to provide a storage capacity of 4,500 million gallons, Bristol Waterworks Company had to divert 3.5 miles of county roads and effectively drown a huge area of the finest farmland in the country. As the lake at its deepest is only 37 feet, they also had to demolish the farms and cottages scattered across it, and the hamlet of Morton. Those people who lived there received compensation and started new lives where they could. This area of the lake is called Morton Point. In the past, you might have looked over to Morton Farm, Wally Court, and Denny Farm, whose name survives in Denny Island. Stratford Mill, a fine old water mill thought to be too important to demolish, was moved, stone by stone, to Blaise Castle Estate in Bristol, where it can be seen today. And now, near the site where the mill stood, other activities are pursued by a band of dedicated ornithologists turned bird ringers. Chairman of the group is Dorian Buffery.
The ringing station has been in existence just over 21 years, and that was not long after various similar groups were set up in throughout the country, and this seems such an ideal place to catch birds for the British Trust for Ornithology. So this is why we started at Chew. It is a very important station because we catch a lot of birds of a wide variety of species.
There's an adult as well.
Ow! I spend nearly every weekend, if I can, which can involve many hours.
Was that tree creeper?
It's a fantastic hobby, and it's a progression from bird watching.
Nice to have a look at that.
Some of the rarer species we've caught are aquatic warbler, which can only have travelled over thousands of miles to get here.
Yeah. Got a robin here.
Little bunting, which should have been somewhere in Southeast Asia, which was blown off course here. There are various lot of summer migrants, which travel 5,000 or 6,000 miles every year to get here.
75?
By catching these birds, you can tell the numbers of birds present throughout the year, whether they've had a good breeding season, how long birds live, which is just as important for common birds, as this data, as for rare birds.
17.6.
There's a lot of water in the Chew Valley, and this spring is largely responsible for much of it. It's the source of the River Chew at Chewton Mendip, which bubbles up through the limestone of the Mendip Hills, winds its way towards the lake, and onward through Kensham to join up with the River Avon. In Chewton Mendip, you'll also find the Chewton Cheese Dairy, where they make traditional cheddar cheese, but on a grand scale. Each morning, visitors roll up to see the start of a show. We gaze in admiration. 2,000 gallons of local milk are transformed to curds and whey, and onwards to the very tastiest of cheddars. Pounded, pummeled and pressed, the pièce de résistance of the Chewton cheesemakers. To allow the cheese to mature and breathe, they cover it with lard. Yes, ordinary lard. And there's no vacuum packing at this production line, as they bandage it with cheesecloth to allow the moisture and gases to escape during the months of keeping. But we'll leave the storeroom with its cold temperature of 10 degrees centigrade, the same as Cheddar Caves, and travel onwards to Blagden. And no one would ever believe, by observing the everyday activity of village life, that it was once the centre of a raging controversy that hit the national headlines of the day. It happened in 1800 and concerned Hannah Moore, the well-known social reformer and writer. By the time Hannah came to Blagden in 1795, she and her followers had already opened Sunday schools in North Somerset, where poor children were taught to read and write and listen to Bible stories. Hannah had the crusading spirit of the evangelical Christian. The more she opened schools, the more the wealthy landowners and the established Church of England felt uneasy. Would the poor lose interest in their work if they were educated? What brand of Christian doctrine was she teaching? Could it be the much-feared but popular New Methodism?
This is the house where the controversy was built up, and where 200 pupils would come each week to her Sunday school. The curate of the church, Thomas Beer, was convinced that Hannah Moore and her teachers had strong Methodist leanings. He published a pamphlet accusing them of just that, and putting his own point of view. Other people soon followed suit. And soon, hundreds of pamphlets, some of them extremely malign, were flying backwards and forwards over a period of 4 years.
In the end, Thomas Beer proved his case against Hannah's staff, and the local bishop and his committee were forced to close the school.
This business didn't stop Hannah Moore carrying on her work, helping the poor. But the slur on her good and just character made her ill. Her sister wrote to a friend, "Hannah is ill again. This affair will, I fear, destroy her." She was 54 when the Blagden controversy began. She continued her good works until she was 88.
Nowadays, the village has an air of calm about it as it ribbons its way gently down to the banks of Blagdon Lake. The lake is stocked with brown and rainbow trout of such high quality that fishermen from all over Europe are drawn here. One man who can't keep away from its shores is Stephen Pope. He's now one of the best fly fishermen in the country and has been coming here since he was just a lad.
Got fish on. It's only a small one though, I think. Yeah, a little one.
Steve, that's pretty good. Is that the first one of the day?
No, this is just a small brownie. It's under 12 inches and I'll put this one back.
Fishermen in other parts of the country look on Blagdon Lake as almost with religious fervour, I think. Why would that be?
It was the first trout fishery to come into existence. It's been in existence since 1904 now. And this is where reservoir fly fishing, as we know it, all started.
What does it really take to be a good fisherman?
Patience, dedication. You've got to put your heart into it, really. It takes a long time. There's no easy way to get there. Any duffer can come down and have a good day fishing, but to do it consistently, you've got to be prepared to put a lot of time and effort into it.
How much time and effort do you put into it?
Throughout the season, 4 or 5 evenings a week, and one day in a boat at the weekend, probably.
So a day out for you is fishing, and fishing only?
That's what I enjoy, yeah. Yeah, it's a pleasurable way to spend a day.
I'll carry on and see if we get another one on the line.
Right.
A journey to Burrington Coombe is one many people make as they leave the Chew Valley. It's not quite as spectacular as nearby Cheddar Gorge, but it has a unique story to tell.
Visitors come here simply to gaze at this fissure in the rock, where, in about 1762, Augustus Toplady, curate at the nearby Blagdon Church, sheltered one day against a terrible storm. On returning to the parsonage, he was so thankful to God that he was inspired to write the hymn, Rock of Ages.
And now, every summer, in July, hundreds of people gather in the Coombe to commemorate Augustus Toplady's work at the Rock of Ages open-air service. For the hymn remains a constant favourite.